said good morning. It is good evening, W3CU. We are so glad that you're here this evening. Welcome to the first night of Revival. We're so glad that you decided to join us. We hope that you continue to join us throughout Revival. We've got tonight, of course, and then Monday through Wednesday at 7 p.m. We would love for you to join us, continuing with our Revival. If you're stressed or worried about getting here on time or coming after work, we are going to be offering food dinner at 5:30 in the back every night, Monday through Wednesday. So you don't have an excuse, so don't say that that's your excuse. So we would just love to have you come and join us. And then also, we just want to mention, Chris had mentioned this a little bit earlier this morning, but we do have Easter cards for you all to pass out as Easter is coming up so soon. So we would love if you would just give those to someone, you know, be prayerful about it, invite them, and like Chris said, say whatever service they're planning on coming to, you're coming to that one too. So we just want to encourage you to do that, and I think that's about all I've got. So if you guys want to go ahead and stand to your feet, we are just going to worship the Lord this morning. Evening.
Come and forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led. Sign that you are with me. Fire by night is a guiding light to my feet. You found, you read, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me. Hallelujah.
can hear you guys singing out there.
Thank you.
to be overcome by your presence, Lord and Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place with the atmosphere. Your glory, that's what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, God of wonders. Your power has no end. The things you've done before, in greater measure, you will do again. 'Cause there's no prison wall you can't break through, no mountain you can move. Oh, possible. There's no broken body you can raise, no soul that you can save. All things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up. You can light it up. In victory, and now you're seated forever on the throne. So why should my heart fear what you defeated? I will trust in you alone. 'Cause there's no prison wall you can't break through. Stronghold will crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Come awaken your people, come awaken the city. God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. I hear the chains. Oh God of revival. will crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. God of revival, pour it out. Cause there's no prison wall you can't break through. No mountain you can move. All things are possible. There's no broken body you can raise. No soul that you can save. All things are possible. Things are possible. Then sings my soul. Speaking to every one of us. Help us, God, to open up our hearts just to hear what Pastor Ricky has to share, but more than that, what the Holy Spirit has to share through him. God, may you have your will and your way in this service. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
Yeah. Good evening. I am so excited about being here and about being with you, and I was just thinking on just how good God has been to me. You know, like, sometimes I think it's a trip. I mean, God is such a trip, because I'm telling you, I shouldn't even be here. Can you believe that? It's like, most of you don't know my story, but I was born and raised in Dallas, Texas, and just an awesome place to live. And I remember at 11 years old, my mother walked into our house and told us she had 10 kids in 10 years. And mama told us, she said, your dad's deceased. And it blew my mind, but not only that blew my mind, but 2 years later, my baby brother Charles picked up a gun, put to his head, and pulled the trigger. But not only that, my brother Wallace went to prison as a kid under 18 years old and came out and became a killer. And he was ultimately shot 13 times and beaten the head with a shovel. And then the following year, I got shot. And I look back at my life and I'm like, God, only you could do that. Only God. Isn't that the truth? Only God can pick us up and turn us around and place our feet on solid ground. Only God can do that. And some of you should be excited, because God, not only can he do it, he will do it. And so I've been so excited about this evening, and really just about this space here and this thing called revival. Because what revival asks the question, where are we spiritually? Revival starts with really assessment of where you are. It really doesn't start with the assessment where God is. God never went anywhere. It starts with us. It is saying, God, where am I in this spiritual journey? God, where am I? Am I just simply going through the motions, or am I on fire? And so this morning, I just want to briefly share with you, if you weren't here this morning, you know, I had so much fun talking about Jeremiah chapter 29, and most of us just read Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you, but what I hope that I helped you understand is that's really not this, it's not this motivational verse. That God really stepped into a very difficult time with the nation of Israel. And God, where the nation of Israel had drifted away from the Lord. And the Lord told him, he said, man, listen, please don't leave me. God begged them. And they went to false gods anyway. And then once they went to false gods, then God says, well, since you're not going to act right on the front end, I'll give you mercy on the back end. So when you come out, I know the plans I have for you. You've got to stay in the fire for a while, but when you come out, and then this is what God says. He says, you are to come, call, and pray. That's your response. He says, I will listen to you. Then God, he comes and he says, not only are you to come, call, and pray, but you are to seek me and seek me with all of your heart. And once you seek me with all of your heart, then you'll find me. I will be found, declares the Lord. Well, that's God seeking you. This evening, I want to go about really a totally different direction because that's the Old Testament perspective of us seeking God. I mean, 113 times in the Bible says, seek God. You remember over in Matthew 6:33? Seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. All throughout scriptures, Jesus comes in Luke 19, verse 10, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. Just over and over and over, God is encouraging us to seek him. Well, today I want to, amen. I'm not going to take long tonight, all right? Come on, now you know you should say amen. Come on. Now, you know it takes me a longer time to preach when you don't talk to me. Now, if you're quiet, I'm going to tell you, you'll get home about 2 o'clock in the morning. But if you help me, we can get through with this in about 20 minutes. Is that all right? And so the question that I wanted to ask you about your faith this evening is, are you pursuing Jesus or are you casually pursuing Jesus? That's the question. Because so many people seek Jesus casually. Oh, I'll just get up and go to church. I wonder who's preaching today. I wonder if my girlfriend or boyfriend will be there. Just kind of casually seeking Jesus. And I mean, can you imagine it? Imagine if you got married. You would not casually pursue your spouse. No, I mean, can you imagine that? You coming down the aisle and then you getting married to this person. And then, I mean, you're doing everything it takes to please them. But the moment you get married, you pull back and you casually pursue them. You know what? That's when marriages get in trouble. When we casually pursue them. No one wants to be casually pursued. And if we don't want to be casually pursued, guess what? God didn't want to be casually pursued. That God wants us to light a fire in our spirit, and he wants us to pursue him like we have never pursued anything before. And so what I'm going to do this evening again is I want to look at this text, and this text is so explosive. I want to talk about a man who really sought God with all of his heart. Isn't that good? I wanted to see this morning, I was trying to tell you what to do. But this evening, I want to talk about how to do it. Because this brother, I mean, he did it in a wonderful way. So let's just jump. Now, this guy, his name is Zacchaeus. And you ever heard of Zacchaeus? Now, most of us have sung the song, Zacchaeus. He was a little bitty man. Yeah. I mean, I was a song one time. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10, but if you don't, we're going to have it on the overhead. Is that all right? So let's read it. Here it is together. Oh, I will read it and you can hear. It says, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him. Since Jesus was coming that way, when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be with the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, Lord, here and now I give half my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came, listen to this, the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Isn't that good? Oh, let me pray. Father, thank you so much for your word. And Father, I pray that you will open our spiritual eyes, that we might see you, Jesus, in a very clear and real way. I pray that your Holy Spirit will move in a powerful way, that, Jesus, we can hear from you in just this awesome way this morning. Father, I pray that there will be someone here today that will respond to your voice as you call. I submit and commit this worship experience to you. In your name I pray, amen. So let's look at it. We're going to look at the story real quick. You know, one of the most fascinating characters in the Bible for me is Zacchaeus. Now, this guy, we often talk about his size, but the one thing that I can say about Zacchaeus is that Zacchaeus aggressively pursued everything he did. This was not some chump. No. Everything he did in life, he went for the gusto. He aggressively pursued it. And so when you look at his profession, he was a tax collector. He aggressively pursued being a tax collector. I would be willing to say that he was probably one of the best around. Because not only did he pursue this career that he was in, he also pursued his position. He wasn't just a tax collector. Listen to what verse 2 says about him. Verse 2 says, you're right here in the second verse. It says this. It says, a man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. Isn't that good? That this guy was not just a tax collector. That this guy was over an entire region. And so when I say he pursued his job, he also pursued his position. He climbed the ladder. And so when I read about Zacchaeus, I have nothing but respect for the brother. There are too many lazy jokers who won't even work today. Amen. Let me leave past that. Have you ever met anybody who just don't want to work, just sorry, lazy, won't do nothing? And so when I look at him, I said, this guy is something else. But not only did he pursue his career, his position, he also pursued his wealth. This guy had some money. I mean, can you imagine at the end of the passage when he said, I'll give half of my possessions to the poor? I mean, you don't have $100 and give half your possessions to the poor, because you're poor too. You know what I mean? No. This guy had money. And this guy, I mean, he pursued this money. So he pursued, listen, his career, his position, his money. He was pursuing everything. And that's why you shouldn't be surprised in how he pursued Jesus. He had a pattern of pursuing everything. And then so he comes here, and this guy who's pursuing everything, listen to what it says. It says that not only did he have these great qualities about pursuing everything, he also had some deficiencies. His first deficiency was that he was short. Oh, yeah. He was a short guy. Now, I got to tell you, because I'm a big guy. Amen. And, you know, I'm very careful when I'm in the presence of people who are not as big as I am. You know why? Because sometimes I can be very intimidating. My wife is 4'11 and a half. Now, can you imagine me walking up and getting frustrated with my wife, how she will respond? She often sits down. And so because I'm a big man, because I have a short wife, whenever we get into conflict, I make sure I'm sitting down. That's right, because I don't want her looking up at me. I want her to look across from me. Amen. Hey, come on, that's an amen, isn't it? Because often what happens when a person is shorter is that they begin to see the world through those lenses. They begin to see everything else as so much bigger. They have bigger goals. That's why he was aggressively pursuing them. Everything's bigger, and he's seeing all these big things around him, and then you bring a guy as big as me come around, he's like, whoa. And so I sit down because I don't want him to see me that way. Not only was he a short man, he was a sinner. That's what the crowd called him. He's a sinner. Well, most of the tax collectors were sinners. They were ripoff artists. They would go in, like, imagine the federal government. You're already frustrated because they're hitting you for 20, 30, 40% of your taxes. Then you get the tax collector say, I'm going to put another 10% on top so I can make me some more money. You lost your mind. And so when the people saw him, they said, that old joker, he's nothing but a sinner. And so you got this guy with all these issues that are coming to the, he's coming to the table. Now, let me tell you what he did. And so you know, I'm going to give you some principles so that you can apply what I'm saying, right? And so what I call these was, so once you look at Zacchaeus, I said, I want to share with you, listen, principles that empowered Zacchaeus to aggressively pursue Jesus. Ah, isn't that good? No, that's what it is. These are going to be some principles. What caused Zacchaeus to aggressively pursue Jesus? And now here's my first one. This is a good one. You better hold on for this one. It says that in his aggressive pursuit of Jesus, Zacchaeus was willing to have what I call a theological suspension of that which was logical. Oh, isn't that good? Did you get what I'm saying? Listen to what I'm saying. A theological suspension of that which is logical. Theology, it just simply means as we look at God, we are going to suspend that which is logical. In other words, that when we look at God, we're going to let go of everything that makes sense. In other words, when we serve God, we should be doing some things that really doesn't make sense. Oh, you should have amen that one. That was better than your amen. Listen, no. As we view God, that we are not here to make sense. We're just simply to seek God. Now, can you imagine what it was like for Zacchaeus? Zacchaeus is a chief tax collector. He has position, he has status, he has a career, and all of a sudden he hears Jesus is coming to town, and guess what he does? He walks over and he says, the little short one, he says, how am I going to see Jesus? All these people are here. Jesus is not going to see me, and I won't see Jesus. But listen to what Zacchaeus does. He, in his double-breasted suit and his Stacy Adams shoes, gets out of his Rolls Royce, walks over to a tree. No, listen. Climbs the tree to position himself to see Jesus. Oh, my God. See, that's what you call a theological suspension of that which is logical. In other words, it didn't make sense. Who do you think climb trees? Who do you think when you think of somebody? Children. You never think of a grown man. I mean, just think. If you drove by here, and if you saw Pastor Chris climbing a tree, what would you say to Pastor Chris? You'll say, man, that man done lost his mind. That doesn't make sense. He should get a ladder. He should get something. But in other words, it really would not make sense. Well, what Zacchaeus was doing is Zacchaeus is saying, wait a minute, man. Listen, I'm going to climb the tree. I am going to do whatever it takes. But my mission is that I see Jesus. And whatever happens, I don't care what people say or anyone else, I am going to see Jesus. And your question is, what are you willing to do that sounds crazy? Let me tell you real quick. I have about 8 minutes, but that's okay. I'm going to get out of here quick. But listen to me. Can you imagine this? Now, I was having a devotion. And you all, next time I'm going to bring a picture of my family because you'll see all my knucklehead children. They are just the best I've ever had, right? And so my children, their mom homeschooled them. She raised them at home. Glenda, when she was at home, she cooked, she cleaned, she washed clothes. Glenda did everything. Well, once my children got older, they left the house, and Glenda decided to go and get her degree in nursing. And so now Glenda's a nurse. And I don't know if you know this, but nurses work hard. There we go. That's right. Nurses will go to work and work 12 hours a day, 4 days a week. They work hard. And so Glenda, she goes to work. And so I was praying one day, and I said, Lord, you know what? How can I serve Glenda? I mean, what can I do to serve Glenda? And so the Lord says, well, won't you do what she's been doing? And I said, wait a minute, Lord. I ain't asked for all that. So I took on some of the behavior that Glenda was doing and that I took for granted. I started cooking for Glenda. And then I said, you know what? I'm going to start cleaning the house for her. So I started cleaning the house for Glenda. And I said, okay, and it's really not for her. It was for me too, right? And then I started saying, okay, now I'm going to wash her car and I'm going to do all these things because she's done it all of our lives. And so all of a sudden, my kids came home for Christmas. And so when they came in, I come down and I have on my apron. And on my apron, it has Big Rick. And so all my kids, I have five, they're all confused. Like, Daddy, what in the world are you doing? So I shared with them. I said, I was talking to the Lord one day, and he told me that I should serve my wife. And so now guess what I'm doing? I cook. But not only do I cook, I clean. And I said, you know what else I do? Because she goes to work and her clothes, they're not clean. I wash her clothes. And my son Caleb looked at me. I mean, I got his name straight out of the Bible. And he said, Daddy, that just does not make sense. And I said, Caleb, what in the world are you talking about? He said, Daddy, that's Mama's job. I said, really? That's Mama's job. Then you need to come help me do it. Get on over here. And he came over. But the kids got in a huddle with me, and they said, Dad, it really doesn't make sense. And my response is, whenever I serve the Lord, what I do doesn't have to make sense. Because my ways are not your ways. That's what the word says. My ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts. I am not here to make sense. I'm here to serve God. And if God calls me to serve my wife, then I'm going to serve my wife. If he calls me to cook, I'm going to cook. If he calls me to clean, I'm going to clean. Whatever God calls me to, then I'm going to do it because I'm not here to make sense out of you with you. I'm here to please my God. That's what seeking God is all about. And if you want to seek him, you better be willing to do something that doesn't make sense. See, for your spouse, it may not make sense for you to wake up early at 5 o'clock in the morning and spend some time with the Lord. For it may not make sense for them so that you're calling them during the day and praying for them. It may not make sense for them to know that you've got these children and that you're loving them and praying. It may not make sense, but you're not here to make sense. You're here to seek God. But let me hurry up and get through here. I told you I'm going to get through quick tonight. Listen. But then this next principle I thought was pretty good, too. Listen to what it says here. In the second principle, it says, in his aggressive pursuit of Jesus, Zacchaeus was willing to extend an invitation despite the crowd's humiliation. No, look at it. Look at it. Now, what I want to show you here, now this is so good. Listen to what I'm saying. I want to convince you that Zacchaeus is seeking Jesus. That's what he's doing. No, if you read verse 3, and you already know from this morning, I like to watch words that repeat themselves. Now, that's what you do. That's how you pick up a theme. In verse 3, listen to what it said. Now, watch the word see. You're going to see it pop up over. Listen to it. In verse 3, it says, he wanted to see. There you go. Good job. Good. You learn. He wanted to see who Jesus was. But because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. Isn't that good? Now, can you believe that this brother was really seeking Jesus? He climbed a sycamore tree, he repositioned himself, but the goal was to see Jesus. Boy, can you imagine if this church got serious about seeing Jesus? Can you imagine if your church, if you're not a member here, can you imagine if they got serious about seeing Jesus? It would blow this town off the map. Folk would be coming from all over the country saying, what in the world is going on? All people just want to come here just to see. It would blow it away. But there's something even deeper. Because when you look at the life of Zacchaeus, listen to what happens. He was so desperate to see Jesus, but what he didn't realize is that Jesus was desperate to see him. Up! Did you get that? See, he was seeking Jesus, but the reality of the story is Jesus was seeking him. Did you hear that? See, this morning what I was teaching you was the Father was waiting for us to call, to come, and to pray. But it was that way because Jesus wasn't here. Now that Jesus is here, Jesus is seeking us. Listen to what it says. Look at the movement. It says that Jesus looked up and saw Zacchaeus. He looked up, and see, what Zacchaeus didn't realize is that as he was climbing that tree, he wasn't climbing that tree to see Jesus. Really, he was climbing that tree so that Jesus could see him. Ah, you missed that, did you? That's okay. And then once Jesus looked up and saw him, listen to what it says. It says, Jesus spoke to him. That all of the people out yelling and waiting to see Jesus, Jesus looked up into the tree, and not only did Jesus see him, Jesus spoke to him. Now listen to this. Jesus called him by his name. Do you know how big that is? When you call somebody by their name, it is so different than just saying, hey, what's up, doc? Hey, homeboy. No. Jesus said, Zacchaeus. What Jesus was saying is, man, you're somebody. You are valuable, Zacchaeus. When you call a person by name, you give them value. And that's, can you imagine that? And so there's so many people in the world that are not even called by their names. They don't have value. And I don't care if you slipped up in here today, and you say, Ricky, you know, I don't really have a lot of value. I don't feel good about myself. I would ask you, what in the world's wrong with you? Because every time Jesus calls us, we have value. We are somebody. That's right. We are somebody. We had Jesus, a Savior, to die for us on a cross, and he made us somebody. But even before that, we were somebody. Yeah, don't you look at me like that. I'll throw some word out on you. No. You remember in Genesis where it says that we were made in the image of God? That when God looks at us, he's like a mirror. That God looks at us, and as he sees us in the mirror, it reflects right back to God. That we're made in his likeness. We're just like him. But then over in Psalms, it says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. But then over in John 1, it says we are children of God. But then in 1 Corinthians 5:17, it says we are new creations. But in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 14, it says that we're God's workmanship, his handiwork, made anew in him to do his work. In other words, you can never allow anybody to tell you, God, somebody, that you're nobody, because you are somebody in the eyes of God. Isn't that something? That's who you are. And you know what? People wonder why I strut around. I can have bad knees, but I'm somebody. No, really, 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 really. I might even be the guy that looks the way you like men to look. But I don't care how I look to you, because I know to him, I am a beautiful, and I am fearfully, and I am wonderfully made. I don't care. And that's why nobody can tell me I'm nobody, because I belong to the King. He calls that tears by his name. And then he goes in, let's look at this. Then Jesus says, come down, Zacchaeus. He gave them an invitation. He says, I must stay at your house. You see, Jesus is seeking Zacchaeus. And if you drop down to the end of the chapter, listen to what it says. It says, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. See, I don't care where you are in your spiritual journey. I know the Holy Spirit is prompting your heart. And what the Holy Spirit is saying, come back to me. Your relationship is distant. Your relationship is far from me. But the Holy Spirit is saying, he said, come back. He's prompting that. He's directing you to come back. But on the other end, you've got Jesus. Jesus is coming and saying, come back to me. I died for you. You are settling for less. Why would you settle for less when you can come to me? And so not only is God calling you to seek Jesus, Jesus at the same time is seeking you. Oh, and then let me help you get out of here. And then I love this part here. Here's my last point. I'm gonna get out of here. But listen to what it says here, number three. In his aggressive pursuit of Jesus, Zacchaeus was willing to give a hefty donation, which was a sign of his spiritual transformation. Ah, that's good, isn't it? Did you like that? Yeah. See, look what he did. He gave this hefty donation. He said this, he says in verse 7, all the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half my possession to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay it back four times. Ah, listen to this. What's so beautiful? I love the way Zacchaeus carried the conversation. Now, there are people who's going to always mutter. That's the crowd. They're going to always have something negative to say. Listen. Never, ever, ever listen to the crowd. You can't. Every time the crowd started talking, somebody got in trouble. You remember when the king asked the crowd, he said, who do you want, Jesus or Barabbas? Kill Jesus. That crowd did that. And now the crowd's talking again. He's with a sinner. They're always putting people down. I'm careful who I listen to and who talks to me. And when it's the crowd, and that's what you should see in this text. Listen to, listen, you got to hear this. It says this here. He says, all the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. Now listen. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, up! He never addressed the crowd. Did you hear what I'm saying? Listen to this. He never addressed the crowd. The crowd is the ones that said, he's a sinner. Zacchaeus ignored the crowd. In other words, you don't need to be in this conversation. And Zacchaeus went and said, Lord, anytime you mention Lord twice, he's got something that he's trying to say to Jesus. And listen to what he says. He says, Lord, if I have, he says, On this day, I give half of my possessions to the poor. Now, notice he didn't say money. That's not what he's talking about. He is talking about his net worth. That when I pull my house and my cars and everything together, I'm going to take this moment and I'm giving half of it to the poor. But that's not enough. Transformation. He says, and if I've cheated anyone, that's why they called him a crook. He said, if I cheated anyone, he said, I will give them, pay them back four times. Imagine if he was worth $100,000. That means that he's going to take 50% of his net worth and give it to the poor. Now he's only worth $50,000. But imagine if he's cheated enough people that another 25% is gone. That means that this guy is willing to say, for the rest of my life, I'm going to live on 25% of God what I have. That's transformation. See, what happened was, because he met with Jesus, Jesus changed the way he saw everything. That's right. That Jesus changed his paradigm. And listen, guys, if you want to seek Jesus, one of the greatest things you can do is change the way you look at things. That you change the way you look at money. You know what? Let me say this here. All my kids, I remember I had a meeting with all my kids. And see, they always get mad at me because daddy says things that they think I'm crazy, right? I went and I met with all my kids and I said, come in here, dad's got a meeting with you. And they said, okay, what is it, daddy? And I said, well, I need to tell all of you that you ain't gonna get a dime from me. I said, when I die, I'm not going to give you a dime. I said, I have educated all of you. All of you have good jobs. You're doing well. And you don't need to be waiting for me to die to give you what I have. You better save up for yourself. And they said, well, Dad, why are you going to do that? I said, well, the scripture says, lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Said, I want to give it all away. I'm not going to just sit here and save all my money and save all my resources, and then I die and go before the Father. And he says, Ricky, you left everything I've blessed you with in the bank. God gives us to give away. He didn't give us to hoard and keep and to stockpile our bank account. No, no, no. See, it changed Zacchaeus' perspective. He was stockpiling, and all of a sudden, he comes in, and he has this face-to-face encounter with Jesus, and he says, wait a minute, God, maybe I need to start blessing people. And let me tell you, I love